Hummel is best known for the oratorio The Messiah, but there are quite a number of other oratorios which Hummel composed, as well as other kinds of music, of course. And what we're going to hear is the theme from a chorus from the oratorio Judas Maccabeus, which recounts the Hanukkah story as described in Maccabees. This is sometimes set to, or a hymn is sometimes set to this tune. You might know it as Thine Be the Glory, the words of which begin, Thine be the glory, risen conquering sun. Endless is the victory thou o'er earth hast won. So we'll hear a little bit of that, and hopefully it'll be recognizable after I've tinkered with it. Okay.
Thank you.
less, more or less, along in chronological order. So that brings us to the music of Ludwig von Beethoven, perhaps one of his most recognizable works. Certainly one that has found its way into popular culture is the Ninth Symphony, the so-called Choral Symphony. You might know this as the hymn, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee. So we will hear that tune next. And it should be easy for you to sift out what is Beethoven and what is Anthony Mort. I know that's potentially sacrilegious to put my name in the same sentence as Beethoven, but I suppose we are all on forgiveness.
Thank you.
classical period. Composer Jean Sibelius was, in addition to being a wonderful poet of sound, was also something decidedly of a patriot, and wrote a tone poem called Finlandia, which he uses sound, the tapestry of the orchestra, to describe his vision of his home country of Finland. The primary theme from that tone poem has been set as a hymn which you will all know as Be Still My Soul, with wonderful, decidedly touching lyrics, at least I think they are. The first verse reads, Be still my soul, the Lord is on your side. Bear patiently the cross of grief or pain. Leave to thy God to order and provide. In every change, he faithful will remain. Be still, my soul, thy best, thy heavenly friend, through thorny ways leads to a joyful end.
Thank you.
Charles Stewart Parry, and the words which we'll hear presently are by poet William Blake. The words actually refer to a legend, possibly spurious, but then I suppose one can never be 100% certain about these things, that at some point Christ our Lord walked various places in the earth, including England, as the legend has it. There's not a lot of biblical precedent for that, nor historical precedent, other than the fact that the gospel accounts of Jesus' life are full of empty spaces. For example, what did Jesus do between roughly the age of 13 and the age of 30, that is between his bar mitzvah and the incident at the temple where his parents were looking for him, and the beginning of his public ministry? Many legends have sprung up about those so-called lost years. Similarly, after the resurrection and before the ascension, Jesus seemed to kind of pop in and out of the disciples' lives. He would quite literally materialize and then vanish just as quickly. And again, where did he go during that time? So again, gave rise to all kinds of creative speculation, including this other wonderful bit of poetry by William Blake. And did those feet in ancient time walk upon England's mountains green? And was the holy Lamb of God on England's pleasant shores seen? And did the countenance divine shine forth upon our clouded hills? Was Jerusalem built it here among those dark satanic mills? Bring me my bow of burning gold. Bring me my arrows of desire. Bring me my spear. O clouds, unfold. Bring me my chariot of fire. I will not cease from mental fight, nor shall my sword sleep in my hand, till we have built Jerusalem in England's green and pleasant land.